I have a word for those who are children of Israel and the 144,000 particularly, and those who will be left behind who will become tribulation saints. You've got the word of God, of course. Revelation is going to be played out, and God will give you the wisdom to understand that with Daniel and Revelation in the spiritual things of God and the natural things. But the Lord says that they have robbed his word. Now, this is the word of the Lord for those who will be left behind. For you, the word of wisdom to deal in Israel is the hammer. And the Lord wants you to know, and the Lord gave me this last week, and I don't think I mentioned it in the video. The word of the Lord to the nation of Israel, follow the hammer. What is the hammer in Hebrew? It's the Maccabees, which was in our original six, you know, for us American Christians, in the original 1611 King James Bible, in the original printings, it was there. The book of Enoch was there. It's been removed. You may have a 1611 King James Bible now that's been printed in the last 200 years. It's not going to be in there. The original ones that were printed for about 200 years, it was in there. And as a matter of fact, there's original copies that's been torn around the United States, and it's in there. And I'm not here to discuss doctrine with trolls. Listen to me, the word of the Lord. And I thank the Lord, because the Lord just corrected me. to use the authority that he gave me. I even made a video about that and haven't posted it yet yesterday. This is the word of the Lord. Maccabees and Enoch, which were both removed from the Bible in the 1700s, actually by forces from rabbinical Judaism, who blocked, as Jesus said about those Pharisees. The Pharisees are rabbinical Judaism today. Is the Pharisees from the time of Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach. And Jesus said about them, you block the entrance to heaven and you will not go in. And you block others from going in. You bind up heavy burdens and put them on the backs of men. Get out of the way. Jesus said, many are called, a few are chosen. He who has an ear, let him hear. Those who this is for will hear by the Spirit of God. And that's what I'm going to start doing by the grace of God, if I remember it, as the Lord is correcting me right now in this video. I'm speaking to those who have an ear to hear. You know, this social media comment stuff, you know, it's not of God to answer to the world or answer to trolls and tares and the devil's people, but to speak boldly the word of God. Amen, brothers and sisters. I will say that right now. I'm in the middle of this video to all watchmen, true men of God who make videos. Hear the wisdom of the Lord. Speak boldly what God gives you to say. No apologies. Only apologize when you said something the Lord didn't want you to say. When you're wrong with the Lord. And that's when we apologize. But we don't worry of how people receive or not receive the word of God, because it's for he who has an ear. Let him hear the message that God would give. Brothers and sisters, there's people that come to the Lord through hearing about heaven. There's people that come to the Lord when they hear about hell. There's people that come to the Lord when they hear about, you know, people, as I mentioned, heaven. People had near-death experiences. Some people come to the Lord when they see a miracle, when they see an answered prayer. So God has all those things. God's told Paul, become all things to all people. Or Paul said, I become all things to all people that I might win some to Christ. Praise God Almighty for that. Blessed be his holy name. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I had to throw that other one out there because the Lord was leading me to say it. So and I guess I need to make another video, because I end up speaking to my Christian audience, not to the ones I meant to. Those who are not saved yet, but will be saved after the rapture. Those tribulation saints and 144,000, the nation of Israel. Maccabees, study Maccabees. For those who will be here during the tribulation, besides Revelation and all that, of course, all those things are going to play out. You can try to follow that. But follow Maccabees as the type and shadow of the tribulation, which it is. I guess I should declare that. I didn't say why. Maccabees is what's going to happen during the tribulation, mid-trib. Maccabees is the second half of the tribulation in shadow and type. The Antichrist will go to Jerusalem. As I mentioned before, this Epiphanes, Antichus Epiphanes the Fourth, he went there and put a statue of Zeus in the temple, as the Lord told us, to the church of Pergamum in Revelation, where the seat of Satan is, that was in Pergamum. That was the temple of Zeus. Jesus called it the seat of Satan. Antiochus, or whatever, Epiphanes the Fourth, he put a statue of Zeus and told people that he sacrificed a pig to it and demanded that the high priest sacrifice a pig to it. And finally, after they had killed, stole, and destroyed lots of people, finally, the father of the guy they called Maccabee, his dad and his sons, they started a resistance movement during that shadow of the second half of the tribulation, brothers and sisters. Listen to me. Even though Israel will flee to Petra, to Basra in the Bible, Petra, modern day, the Rose City out there in Jordan during the second half, that's still the word of the Lord for you, brothers and sisters. Maybe there'll be people that don't flee. I don't know what all it means. It doesn't matter. You know, it's not for us to reason why, but ours to do or die and to speak what the Lord would have us say. Enoch, the book of Enoch quoted throughout the Bible, many times. Even the Lord calls himself the Son of Man. That title is repeated all through the book of Enoch about the coming Messiah, the Son of Man. It's mentioned one time in Daniel chapter 7. But it's the title for the Messiah all through the book of Enoch. Jesus speaks and quotes directly from the book of Enoch many times. Many times. I assure you that the original book of Enoch, which we have in the text they have today, the original text is within that text. And experts, ancient language experts, can tell you which parts are archaic language and which parts are not, or if any parts are not. Ancient language experts. That's how they examine texts and do critical examination of the text. Anyway, I'm getting into teaching instead of preaching here. Anyway, brothers and sisters, the book of Maccabees, for those who will be left behind, particularly in Israel, the book of Enoch, as it says, Enoch, in the very beginning of the book of Enoch, it says, Enoch sent from Adam, who wrote this book for those who are living in the last days. He wrote them all about the Nephilim, all about the watchers, the fallen angels, all those things that are coming back right now as the days of Noah were, Jesus said, Matthew chapter 24, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. What was new, unique in the days of Noah? Not that they were being married and given in marriage. People have always been doing that. That just talks about it was sudden. But what was unique about those days? That the fallen angels had slept with the daughters of man and had giants. Genesis chapter 6. Most of these old theologians, they don't take the Bible literally, and they don't want to touch that text with a 10-foot pole. They come up with all kinds of wacky doctrines that are total nonsense to try to explain away what is written in the plain text, Genesis chapter 6. The Nephilim are the offspring. They were giants, six fingers and six toes, offspring of the fallen angels and earthly women. As above, so below, the square and compass, the phallus in Washington, D.C., known as the Washington's Monument, a real obelisk made of one solid stone. There, from Heliopolis, Helios is another name for Apollo, Apollyon, the destroyer, right there in Vatican Square, in front of the dome on top of the Vatican, the pregnant belly of the earthly woman bearing forth that Nephilim, that Antichrist, that perversion, that beast, first and second beast. A beast is not a man. It's not a dog. It's a beast. It's a freak. It's not made in nature. It's Satan trying to be a creator, creating a new creature. Just like with all this DNA stuff and hybridization and all these things. God made a spirit for man. God made a spirit for a dog. If you put a dog and a man together, what spirit does it have? It has a beast. A vessel to hold the spirit of a demon. What is a demon according to the book of Enoch? The disembodied spirit of a fallen angel's offspring. A demon is a Nephilim that's died. A fallen angel is a fallen angel. A demon is the spirit, disembodied spirit of their offspring, brothers and sisters. It's what the book of Enoch tells us. Lots of times people get demons and fallen angels mixed up. Two different things, as I just explained. People don't know that. Read the book of Enoch and you'll know that. Praise God. Or you just heard it now in this video. Praise God, brothers and sisters. The Lord has given me more things. I want to make sure I say it. So, brothers and sisters, prepare. Prepare to depart for the bride. Make yourself ready. Be right with God. Let me ask you a question to the church. Even though my videos, I got to do a specific video. Just cut it short for them. You know, just... to the point. If you, most, a lot of you, well, about half of you are women, half of you are men. Let's just suppose if you're a man, or you're the woman, and you're getting ready to get married, and you were engaged, and about betrothed, you're engaged to be married, and then your fiance says, you know, I'll be there next week, you know, I've got to go out of town, I'll be back next week, and I'm going to come get you. Let's go get married, you know, and elope and get married. That's what the Lord's going to elope with the church. And Song of Solomon chapter 2, come away with me, he says to the bride, to the Shulamite, the Gentile woman, the dark woman, the Shulamite woman. So, the man arrives at the house of the bride, the fiance, and she is in the bed with another man. You know, and that's why God called Israel, you know, Ephraim and Judah, you know, that they were prostitutes and all this other stuff, because they were a whoring after other gods, God said. Terms that God used to the prophets. They were whoring after other gods. Okay, so here you come as the, if you're the man, you show up, you go there, and then the woman is in a bed with another man. Are you going to say, hey, come away with me, I love you? Are you going to call her a whore or whatever? You're not going to marry her. You're not going to take her and marry her. If you're the woman, you're in the bed with another man, do you think that the bridegroom's going to take you? No! So what is the gods in your life? You know, what's, you know, people say, oh, well, you know, I'm not worshiping a Buddha or anything like that. But you have other gods in your life. Could be the love of money. Lots of people, it's the love of money. It's the things of this world. Maybe it's an addiction to pornography, drugs, I don't know. Whatever it is, the things that you love more than God. You know, just like the wife of Lot. She was in love with the city life and the world so much, and that's what she's a type of us. She turned back. See, the thing is, I can't remember if I mentioned this in the video or not. The Lord gave me this nugget of wisdom. See, we're supposed to be salt and light. And then here's Lot's wife, looking back and loving up on the city. God turned her to a pillar of salt. See, so she became the salt she should have been in Sodom and Gomorrah. Who knows if Lot and his wife had been better salt and light in Sodom and been an example there. Who knows, you know, the outcome that would happen in Sodom over time. We don't know. We don't know what effect they would have had or not. All we know is that Lot's wife loved the world so much it was a god to her, an idol to her, and God judged her for that. He turned her into the salt she should have been all along. You know, because if she had been salt and light, she wouldn't have been moved by the things of the world, especially an evil, evil place like San Francisco. Oh, excuse me, Sodom. As God even calls Jerusalem or Israel, Sodom and Gomorrah. Anyway, brothers and sisters, there's lots of things else that the Lord gave me to say, and I can't remember now, but praise God, I've got to make these short, quick videos, not for you guys. I made one that I posted quick and short just for Israelis, and then I had Christians on their posting saying, well, you know, you didn't say this, you didn't say that, trying to critique the message that the Lord gave me for Israel. Listen, brothers and sisters, the Jews have been rejecting Christ for 2,000 years. What happened in the Crusades and all that, when the Catholics went there and killing the Jews and set their synagogues on fire, locked them inside, set them on fire, dancing around, singing, you know, that they were praises to Jesus. You know, the cross has been a bad thing to the nation of Israel through the history of the church. They've been persecuted a lot by alleged Christians. Of course, those people weren't Christians. We know that. When they hear Christian, they think, you know, the Pope, they think the Vatican, they think the Crusades, they think all these bad things. So God, it reaches them in a different way. As the Bible says, Jews seek after a sign. So God deals with them in different ways, brothers and sisters. Even though some get saved through the regular way, a remnant has always been there, as I said. God deals with them in a unique way because they're already in the old covenant. That's why I want to explain something to you. Acts chapter 2, when they were baptized in Jesus' name, they were already part of God. They'd already been baptized in the mitzvahs and all that stuff, and people that got baptized by John, they already had God. And they were completed. When a Jewish person becomes a Christian, They're adding Yeshua to be a completion in the capstone, the corner that the builders rejected, you know, the stone that the builders rejected has become the capstone. They have rejected the Messiah. So when they get baptized, Jewish people are baptized in the name of Jesus because they're adding that. That's why you see that in Acts chapter 2. For us Gentiles who are lost and without hope and strangers and enemies of God, the Bible says, when we get saved, that's why the Lord said baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Because we are receiving all of it. We didn't have nothing. Whereas they already have God, they're adding the Messiah. They already accept the others and they're adding the Messiah. See that? Now that, what I just told you right now, is standard theology across the board in all of evangelicalism and Protestantism and everywhere you go, except for the United Pentecostals and the Apostolic Church. They are what they call Pentecostal oneness. They don't believe in the Trinity, and they believe that you're baptizing in the name of Jesus.